Hello, Narnach here. Welcome back to Path of Exile. Playing in the Hardcore Legacy League as a solo self-found Deadeye. And today we're going to continue in Act 1 of Merciless. We have a Tormented League Stone, we have a Prandus League Stone, and we have a Prophecy League Stone. So these are simple Fire and Forget League Stones that I don't really mind if we don't get all the objectives or all the things from them when playing through. As you might notice, the breach stone from last time is no longer there. It was a fun thing to do, but I think it's better to just not play breach anymore. It went all right. But that's of course because I didn't get one of those lucky or unlucky Chayula breaches. So with negative 60 chaos, that's too big a risk. Not entirely sure if they could potentially spawn outside of maps. I've only seen them 2 or 3 times and those were all inside of maps. But it's just too big a risk and I don't want to take it. That's that for now. But as I said, it's the situation where I end up effectively with my back against the wall. It worked out pretty all right, but I don't think it's a good playing pattern for me to get into. Oi, stop backstabbing me, you silly golden goose. So back to doing all other things except for breaches. Let's see, 7 additional items, sure. And cost of clouds, so let's take a step back here. Pick up a decoy totem. And clear the room. And of course, nothing truly of value will drop. And we get a corrupted side area. Negative 12 to maximum player resistances. Increased monster damage. One thing to keep in mind here is if there's going to be a reflector, that's going to hurt because my resist's 64 to cold rather than 76. So rather than taking 24% of the reflected damage, I take 36. So effectively this reads as reflected mobs do 50% more damage. Go. Reflect shrine? Or shrine? You know what? I'm actually gonna switch out of cold pen into lesser multiple projectiles. It lowers my damage and therefore it helps to keep me safe against the odd reflector if I see one. Freezes you when activated, so let's not be frozen. So, to a certain degree, the reflect damage, you could almost treat it like back in the old days with Diablo 2 against Iron Maiden, if you remember that. In the Chaos Sanctuary you had the knights that cursed you. They cast Iron Maiden on you, which effectively, especially at higher levels, you do 10 to 15 times your damage belt dealt back to you. So it's not 20% reflect, it's 1000 to 1500% reflect. Because, well, Diablo, they did like their big numbers already back then. That's it didn't come from nowhere, of course. But if you were playing a high powered melee build, then of course you hit 10 times the damage, you are gonna murder yourself. So the trick there was to effectively just switch into just a broken club or something really, really low damage, so that if you were hit with attack and you could get Iron Maiden cast upon yourself, then you wouldn't really murderize yourself because your damage output was so pitiful that even with Iron Maiden you wouldn't kill yourself. Since then, the devs have actually removed Iron Maiden from the curse pool available to monsters. And the, I think it's the Oblivion Knights, those casters, they are no longer as feared, and Chaos Sanctuary is no longer as dangerous as it was before. But back in the old days, it it was something that you actually accounted for. I was on a similar level of always having a plan for elemental immunities, things like that. But now that we are no longer in the immunity area, might as well switch back to our high-powered setup. Because, well, dealing with rares, it works way better while we're doing a lot of damage. So, now that we're actually just playing through, for fun, we could actually just put GMP in. Just switch it around, so we get a boatload of arrows, but our damage output is pretty low. 4000 DPS, yes, that's just trash tier level damage, isn't it? Slightly kidding there. It's still pretty good. Oh, for this stage in the game, not entirely sure. We're mostly clearing white mobs. And our single target frenzy utility thing is still doing less DPS, so I guess we're doing something right. So this is with greater multiple projectiles. We shoot seven projectiles? Yeah, seven arrows. And there's a ghost up ahead. Who has possessed this dude? And we're still freezing him. So, well, it's not as bad. Really. It's also pretty difficult to actually miss something now. And you can just walk into a room and shoot and effectively hit everything. It is kind of funny, I have to admit, this is kind of funny. It's not as ineffective as I thought it would be or remember it to be. I think I tried it before, and then it was a pretty steep damage penalty. Now it's sort of kind of fun. Just look at the carnage. When it crits, it crits. And then it is glorious. Also, I don't think... Oh, actually, there is a path through here. There is. Okay. Apparently, it's really difficult to hit this dude. Okay. So, somewhere in two screens, something drops. Ooh, the Warden. Corrupted Amulet. Taka, a Badge of Office. Dreadmaw, hey. Hey, don't think I recognize this. Also, I think now we do have enough charges. So what is this? Bullhammer. Void Home. Increased duration on enemies, stun duration on enemies, increased physical. 165 to 223 is not quite bad. It's really not quite bad, especially if you consider 50% increased attack speed. So that's 390 or so damage divided by 2. That's just under 200. Damage per hit, 1.88 attacks per second. That's gonna take you close to 300 physical DPS. Well, produced rarity of items found, produced experience gained, and physical attack damage leeches life. That's interesting. So you get quite some power, but it comes at a price. A very, very steep price, actually. Ah, we found ourselves the silver coin bearer. Ooh, artisan. That's gonna be good. It explodes. No. Plus one chest level. Nope. Freezes you. Nope. Summon skeletons. Okay, we'll settle for this. Quantity increased and a stream of monsters. So, move over there. Did we just one shot the entire pack? Wee! Loot everywhere. Forward could be just a simple run through. I'm spending way too much fun on here, but I'm just having way too much fun just murdering things and blowing things up and having some fun in side areas, experimenting a little bit with some skills. But then again, I'm not a racer, and I never claimed I was playing 100% efficiently. Oh, come on. This is pretty satisfying, right? Just exploding half a screen of mobs. But it would be rather nice if the warden would show his face. Because we do have places to be. We have a Merveil to kill, actually, for this episode. And it's always nice if we can get through Act 1 in 2 episodes. So, unfortunately, for the recent bits, I've always managed to make a stop at the entrance to the prison rather than after defeating the warden, but warden is mostly located in like 2/3 of the way through. So yeah, it's a bit of an awkward stopping spot if you play through the warden and then stop. In the faster leagues, if you don't really get stopped a lot by a lot of mechanics, or if you just have a build that just simply can run through things a little bit faster, that's all right, of course. That works pretty well. But this being a ranged build, I have to pay a little bit more attention to positioning, retreating, things like that, if I wanna adopt a more proper playstyle that's has a decent chance of actually not murderizing me in the end game. True horror. Well, is this true horror? Every shot is about 20% of your health.
I've done for you what I would do for any wounded animal, Brutus.
Yeah, so we still have Legacystones, so we can just simply push forward. Yeah. Let's empty your pockets and then push forward. And for now, we'll just simply put stuff away. Also, we have been finding a bunch of Legacystones, so probably should bring them along. Domination Legacystones, extra shrines, rampage, they're fun. And we just keep our current ones in there as well. And then we got a little bit of a pool of things to pick from. And now, let's move forward. Note to self, teleporting aggressively forward with mirror arrow, maybe not the best of ideas, because effectively you'll be blindly teleporting into packs of monsters. A little bit about Frostwall. I still have mixed feelings about it. It's, that's the motherlode. When I play in a defensively responsible manner. Let's go with that for wording. When I play in a defensively responsible manner, so I keep my distance, keep my enemies away, mostly keep enemies on one side of me rather than getting surrounded from multiple angles, then it's pretty cool actually to have the Wall of Frost, because if I get hit by something, that means stray projectiles from monsters. So I think I still have a piety to chat with. But then the projectiles are coming from one direction, the monsters are going to be in one direction, so any frost walls that get summoned, all they do is of course keep the monsters at bay and protect me from melee mobs, jumping goats notwithstanding. When I, however, play in any situation where that's not the case, then of course it has the potential to actually block my retreat path, which is not very useful. Of course, I have Blink Arrow, but Blink Arrow, it's not an instant teleport. So in case of panic and some time to extract myself, it's useful. But it's mostly a utility thing for controlled movement rather than a panic I get out of here button. Also funny that this appeared empty, and then you port in and then all stuff comes from the floor. Situation like that doesn't really help, but if the mob had still been alive by the time the cosmic damage taken went off, then it would have actually pushed the melee mob back a little bit, potentially giving me some space to put between me and my foe. So it's a mixed bag, and especially for boss fights it has the potential to work against me, because it just makes positioning more difficult. But in regular gameplay, there's advantages to it. So it's still on probation, let's put it that way. Well, yeah, I might just go with something else. Maybe put an increased duration in there or something, and just keep it simple. Just Immortal Call, I'll make that one go off as often as possible and stick around as long as possible. And of course, if you're not using endurance charges, then increased duration actually makes a lot of sense. If you're actively using endurance charges in order to fuel your Immortal Call, then increased duration is not going to add as much, because it's a stacking increased duration. It's not a more duration multiplier that gets applied to it. But in my case, no, I don't use endurance charges, so increased duration could actually work. Oi. Okay, that was a bit of a dead end, so we follow the water to the other side. In a couple levels, we'll be done boosting our life for now. Well, we'll actually be done boosting our life on the skill tree, and then we'll start focusing on boosting our damage output, most notably focusing more on crits, focusing even more on crits. That's maybe a better way to put it. Then the King of the Hills knockback on crit is going to become even more reliable. And let's see, we did find the All Flame. Are we still? Yeah, we need to add one extra. We have an invasion that's actually perfect for down there. Small area, you're more or less guaranteed to see everything. So invasion boss, yes please. So we're being awaited by a rare once up there. So knowing that there's going to be an invasion boss, I'll just switch to cold penetration to amp up our single target damage by quite a bit. Okay. So we got the guarded by magic monsters prefix, which the game considers to be a downside. So we're just gonna get an upside, which is identified items, which can be so much worse. So it's always so much more useful. So technically it's an upside, but meh. One that never really gets me all that excited about it. And of course, because of world invasion, we're gonna get something that's maybe not overly linear in terms of layout. Most of the time, this is a pretty predictable map with a pretty predictable direction to go in. And now there's just a lot of directions we can actually branch out into. Also, I wanna pick this one up. Yes. Is this dead end or the way forward? That's the questions of life. Tormented Rogue. Boom. Two-shotting ghosts, that's still something that remains very intensely satisfying. So I'm assuming this is the way forward, that I don't think there was a boss there. There were some ghosts, but I don't think there was an invader boss. So for now, we'll just ignore the way back and see. Yeah, horrendous mobs. And that was the horrendous gang. More coins, always good. 85 coins from two or three areas now. Spirit and Feeble. This case, oh, the thing dropped on top of me. Oh, Guardian of the Mount, that's well, invader I haven't seen before, so that's good. No, not overly exciting. Well, then again, the not overly exciting part, of course, comes from the fact that I'm still 9 levels over leveled. I really should get to Act 3, Act 4, and start doing maps. Because that's where the true challenge is gonna be. But that said, bit more life would be useful. Okay, ship graveyard, we'll just push forward to the Merveil point and then we'll teleport or pat back. It's the usual.
Come to me, Exile.
Hey, Katarina, what do you want me to do? Send me over there. Ooh, gem cutters. Oh, there's stuff in the way. Grayshriek. You are in the way. Thank you for the stone. So let's try this again. Magic monsters, 6 additional items. That's okay. Anything useful? Anything shiny? Nope. Especially now that we got Siosa. Getting stuff from the strongbox this late in the game is no longer as exciting. Of course, the quality gems still very nice. Gem cutter prisms are still very nice. Yeah, it was an okay enough roll to just go with it. And that's always an interesting bit, an interesting trade-off in game design, where, well, adding one thing to the game, in this case, Siosa selling gems, also effectively, it has impact on other parts of the game, which in this case is the gym cutter strong boxes, because their added value for solo self-found is no longer as high, because you can actually buy the gems. Oh, don't get me wrong, the quality of life improvements from Siosa selling old gems is insane. It actually makes it possible so you can play any build you want. You don't need to specifically roll multiple characters to get the rewards you want or need to rely on masters or blind luck in order to obtain certain gems. All you need to do... Oh wow, we actually ran out of everything at the same time. Let's see. So, domination, anarchy, and invasion for... Oh, we're actually completely empty. That's good. Then we'll just reroll this area after we're done. the upside, of course, is now that we can play any build we want without having to rely on luck. So that's a good thing. But gem cutter strong boxes do lose a little bit of their value now. Also, it's quality. We'll take it. Okay, and that. Yes, that's a good reason to go back to town, empty our pockets, get our skill point, and move forward to kill the boss. But do you have an Ursine pelt? Sure. Pistol. Book of skill. Tackly. Yes. One of the advantages of not going to town all that often is, of course, that everybody always has something to gift to you. Like your biggest cheerleaders. And why did I pick up a belt? I shouldn't have picked up a belt. What do we get? Cold rest, lightning rest, that's 48 total. Bit of evasion, attack speed, 1-2 added damage. Still life on here. From the looks of it, there's no hybrid rolls, so this is actually just a fully rolled gloves. We can't mastercraft anything on top. Technically, it's more resistances, but 64 life is pretty huge. So we can just sell that. Let's see, this one has life and lightning resist. That's a pretty okay. Low evasion rating and a stun and block recovery. That's probably a hybrid roll, so that means we have an FX available. Not too deep into knowing whether it's a prefix or a suffix. It would be really nice if, from an interface design perspective, if there could be like a dividing line between the prefixes and the suffixes, so you would know the prefix or suffix slots that are available still. Oh, simple quality of life improvement would be so helpful. But we'll roll that one later. We'll see what happens. Let's see, what's up here? Really poor in resists. Accuracy in life is okay. A bit of fire damage. But everything else. Nope. That's it. So currently we are going for bravery. More life. Nearly 3000 life. Our evasion is up to 51%. That is of course projected against mobs of our own level. So that's against level 67 foes. We are a couple levels higher than that, so of course we're gonna be effectively evading a bit more this low in the game. Also, I should have rerolled this one, right, with extra mods on it. Okay, evade a boss, 2 magic packs, we're gonna get rogue exile and 2 shrines. I'm not gonna roll all of them, not gonna find all of them, I mean, but having the opportunity to see them is gonna be fun. I still have to check off a bunch of invader bosses from my checklist. So Well, getting the opportunity to do that is pretty darn wonderful. Let's see. That's not a way forward. So right there. Ghosts, they are so easy to overlook. They're slightly too well camouflaged. Okay, there's a rare there, there's another rare over there. Let's just retreat a little bit, put up a decoy. And then let's have a look. The Wrath. 10 Chaos Orbs, if you get an obscene amount of them, of course. Game never gives out something for free or in an easy way. So, Rush Zombies, that's probably going to be Minara, yep, over there. Minara's gone. Also, get out of my face. That was rather nice. Is this a path? This is a path. Could be the way forward, could be a dead end. Bit difficult to estimate. No, this is indeed the way forward. Haven't seen the invader boss. We'll see. As I said, if we miss out on something special, then well, too bad. Not gonna cry over it. Merveil might cry over the loss of her daughter. On the other hand, she really has a lot of children, so I'm not sure if she's gonna miss one or two of them. Okay, so we missed out on an invader boss. Let's keep the frogs at a distance. That's the one interesting thing of invader bosses. At any point in the level, you could just be walking into a boss fight. So having good single target damage setup is pretty useful there. Let's see, let's identify this. That's nice corpses. Oh, yep. Double strong boxes, that's of course pretty brilliant. What's in the box? Rogue Exile. Curse, Lightning Storm. Sure, I don't think I like detonate too much. Plus one chest level. And a stream of mobs, sure. So we'll put a distraction totem in the middle, and then we'll just trigger them both at the same time, and we'll just have a bit of a shooting fish in a barrel fest. Iron Dark Shroud, get out of my face, please. Yeah, like that. And then we'll just continue shooting the fish in the barrel. Well, proverbial fish in a proverbial barrel. 20% quality, that's of course instant currency, that's always nice to grab. Resistance Shrine, that's also pretty darn nice. And with the amount of rares, it's almost like we're playing on a Nemesis map, but this is not actually a Nemesis map. Ah, some monsters guarding shrines are rares. That's sort of kind of Nemesis-y. Nemesis-y. Look, that's the Alpha Paradise. You devour corpses, but on the other hand, You can't really if you're frozen and shattered. Freezing and shattering is definitely a very nice property to help deal with things that explode corpses or devour corpses or use corpses in any way, shape or form. As you can see, it's not 100% reliable, but it helps a little bit. And the more we crit, the better it's gonna get. And the shrine, that means we're probably really close to Merveil herself. Exactly, see? This is my luck. I always hit a shrine about 2 screens away from the exit. Skill point, let's spend this one. More life, and it pushes us over 3,000 life. Ah, actually, it carries on, of course. Tuck, 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 tuck. Chain gun. Hey, that was the first stage. Oh, wow. Well. Acceleration shrine combined with the onslaught. That's almost like cheating. But it's pretty brilliant. I really did enjoy that. And that gets us further in, so let's shoot some monkeys and then move forward. I have learned that if you're looking for specific things, there is an area down here, down the start of the area, where some mobs also spawn. And well, it might be that a shrine pops up here, or a strongbox, or like an invader boss. 20% quality, that's pretty cool. But of course, nothing truly interesting. And we have some space for that. So, let's hunt for an invader boss. There's a reflector there. And nice, we got a desert map. I'm finding enough tier 1 maps already that I have upgraded a couple of them already into tier 2 maps. I think for the factory I even have 2 copies, so that means I upgraded 6 of the lower tier versions into set maps. Also, let's maybe not focus too much on the inventory, Tetris, and just push forward. But yeah, upgrading maps, it works reasonably well. Especially this early, it's nice to just build up a little bit of a mapping pool via just upgrading tier 1 maps into tier 2 maps, so you're not completely reliant on luck. Hey, Revenant! You used to guard the docks, now you're hunting the forest. I'm not always as lucky with map drops as I would like. So if I can already just get some of the upgraded maps just lined up, ready to go, that's just gonna help to set up a good mapping pool. Also, I don't like you. You try to hit me in melee and you jump. Kind of defeating the whole purpose of that wall there. Doesn't really work that well. And something is cursing me. Hex font, yeah. So let's not. But of course, now that we have defeated the invaders, I could technically switch back to greater multiple projectiles just for easier clear speed, especially with all of these apes. It would be easier, but not the end. We're already in the forest encampment, so we don't really need it anymore. With that, we have reached Act 2. So, quite a bit longer episode than normal, but well, I was enjoying myself and there was just a lot of things to do on the way there. So, for Act 2, I hope that we can complete it once again into 3 parts. right side, left side, north side. It's becoming a bit of a standard deal. But for now, I'm gonna thank you very much for watching, and hope to see you again next time. Bye bye.